2-FMA is a research chemical in the substituted amphetamine class. It's primarily been used since 2012, and there's basically no research available on it. Since the drug mainly offers a productive form of stimulation, some users have found it's a good alternative to amphetamine and lisdexamfetamine. As always, there will be more information and links to references on the drugclassroom.com, which you can find using the link below. Since this is a research chemical, it's important to minimize your use of the drug. Among the positive effects are stimulation, increased motivation, mood improvement, increased concentration, increased sociability, and greater talkativeness. The negative effects can include increased heart rate, dry mouth, appetite reduction, increased blood pressure, sweating, and muscle tension. 2-FMA is very much a functional stimulant and work aid rather than a euphoric and inherently recreational substance. It may be close in structure to methamphetamine, but it is not as recreational. Because of these factors, redosing is less of a concern. Most users describe it as clean due to its relative lack of physical side effects. It tends to offer a fairly calm stimulation that helps people focus on the task at hand. For some people, this is a very useful and enjoyable effect. They have the energy necessary for work, but it doesn't leave them feeling like they're on a strong stimulant. Although motivation may be present and you can feel a bit happier, the mood enhancement is not as strong as it is with some stimulants. One of the most common comparisons is to lisdexamfetamine. Both are fairly long-lasting and are mainly productive stimulants at common doses. In general, lisdexamfetamine and amphetamine will offer more mood enhancement. It could also be compared to caffeine and modafinil, though it's typically more enjoyable than those. Because of its productive and clean nature, some people have opted to use it daily or near daily. I'd recommend against that for right now. As long as you take a common dose, it's usually free of most negative effects. There's little to no jitteriness, sweating, or anxiety. When using strong doses, sweating, jaw tightness, muscle tension, and occasionally palpitations may develop. There's very little come down at common doses, which is one of the positive qualities of the substance. Noticeable after effects are more likely at strong or higher doses. They can range from slightly lower motivation and low mood to moderate depression. Some people have combined it with other drugs to produce a more entactogen and MDMA-like experience. One of those combos adds 2-FMA to 5-MAPB and 4-hydroxy-MET. The 2-FMA is primarily a source of stimulation in that combo. It's not clear how safe the combination is, but it's probably of little concern if taken every few months. Orally, the duration is around 5 to 8 hours, with an onset of 30 to 60 minutes. The core effects typically last for about 5 to 6 hours, while wakefulness can persist for up to 8 to 10 hours. 2-FMA is a substitute amphetamine. It's a member of a group of fluorinated amphetamines, such as 2-FA and 4-FA. We don't know how the drug is functioning. Currently, it's believed to function as a releasing agent and reuptake inhibitor for dopamine and norepinephrine. There could potentially be other actions, but they've yet to be investigated. A light dose is 10 to 20 milligrams, a common dose is 20 to 40 milligrams, and a strong dose is 40 to 50 milligrams. Most people find there's little reason to go over 50 milligrams. After that point, the stimulation can increase and the duration may change, but the negative effects also build. 2-FMA has a very limited history. In August 2007, a capsule seemingly originating from Knee Organics was delivered to Royal Adelaide Hospital in Australia. The capsule seemed to be a product called Subcoca 2. It was found to contain 2-FMA. From September 2013 to June 2015, 2-FMA was found in a couple seized drug samples in Italy. The drug was only reported to the EMC-DDA once before 2013. All of this indicates its use was fairly low relative to other research chemicals up to that point. Most user reports have appeared since around 2012 to 2013. It's never become one of the most common research chemicals. As of 2017, it is still on the market. It is uncontrolled in the US. There are laws covering 2-FMA in China, Germany, and the UK. It is also likely covered by Canada's amphetamine laws. Since we don't have much information to go on, it's wise to use the lowest possible dose as infrequently as possible. It appears an overdose could lead to anxiety, cardiovascular concerns, and a higher seizure risk, though we don't have any published overdose cases to learn from. The primary concerns people have mentioned have to do with cardiovascular and kidney health. As long as you stick with common doses and don't use too often, those concerns probably aren't too significant, but we certainly don't know for sure. 2-FMA has shown up in just one published fatality. In 2014, a man in his 20s died with multiple drugs in his system. Based on his manner of death, it's unlikely 2-FMA was really a contributing factor. Some of the risky combinations include other stimulants, MAOIs, and tramadol. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comment section. In order for the drug classroom to provide more education, support is necessary. And the best way to support is through Patreon at patreon.com/thedrugclassroom. You can also contribute through PayPal or Bitcoin. You can reach me on Twitter at Seth A. Fitzgerald and via email at seth@thedrugclassroom.com. More information and links to references can be found on the TDC website using the link below.